So in this video, we're going to talk about how to diagnose myocarditis and pericarditis. Both diseases are somewhat similar in terms of where they happen and the fact that they're both inflammatory processes. So a lot of the labs we'll talk about are indicative of both disorders. But as we talk about more and more invasive tests that we can do to determine what's going on, we'll see when we can discriminate and say this is myocarditis or this is pericarditis. So let's start by talking about certain labs that you can order or things that you can analyze in our blood. So let's say I've got this vial right here. So there's a green top on this vial. And here's the rest of the vial as it goes down here, curves right back up. And this guy is going to be filled with blood. So there are a couple of things we can look at. First of all, there's the white blood cell count. The white blood cell count. And this isn't very specific. It's increased in all types of inflammation. So this could be inflammation from an infection. It could be from an autoimmune disorder. Or if you're in a car accident, a traumatic injury can also cause inflammation and an increase in your white blood cell count. Other than that, you can also look at what's referred to as the erythrocyte. I'll write this out. This is the erythrocyte, which you might recognize as the term for a red blood cell. The erythrocyte sedimentation. Sedimentation is the process of blood or some fluid resting after it's been spun in a vial, if it sediments down. So erythrocyte sedimentation rate. So that's also referred to as the ESR, the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, the ESR. And this has the same feature as being increased in inflammation as well. So it's not specific to myocarditis or pericarditis versus other types of inflammatory processes. There's also another marker we look for that's called C-reactive protein. C-reactive protein, which is a protein that's made in the liver. So I'll just write CRP. That's often what you see it's called on a lab results sheet. CRP. And it's produced in the liver, and it's also nonspecific. This is also increased in inflammation. Increased in inflammation. But we're narrowing down. Now let's get to more specific labs. We can order what's called a creatine phosphokinase level. So a creatine phosphokinase level, it's an enzyme, right? That's what anything that ends in ace refers to. Creatine phosphokinase, it's a CPK level. And we're looking to see how much of this enzyme or this protein has leaked into our bloodstream. And this is more specific because it's increased in our bloodstream when there is damage to the heart, brain, or some muscle. Heart, brain, or muscle damage. Heart, brain, or muscle damage. Which means that if a person has myocarditis, or if a person has just run a marathon, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference just by looking at the CPK level. They'd both be elevated. But perhaps one of the more specific labs, or the most specific lab that you can order, is what's called a troponin level. A troponin level, which you might recognize as a protein that's responsible for contraction of muscle, and it's present in the heart if you look at certain isomers of it. But a troponin level will be elevated when there is heart tissue damage. Heart tissue damage. So it's very specific for some cardiac process. And this is one of the first labs we'll ask for when we suspect someone's having a myocardial infarction or an MI or a heart attack. And this also can help us distinguish between myocarditis and pericarditis, because you can get an elevated troponin level with acute or fairly early myocarditis. So acute or fairly early myocarditis, because you have damage to the myocardium, the heart muscle, which is where you store your troponin. Or you might see it in late, relatively later pericarditis, because the pericardium is not a muscle. It lines the muscular layer of your heart, and so if the pericardium is compressing on the heart, perhaps you'll have troponin leak from the heart eventually, but that'll have to be late pericarditis or more advanced pericarditis. All right, so these are all the labs that we would order. Let's move on and let's talk about how we can use an an electrocardiogram. An electrocardiogram, which if you were to abbreviate, we would call it an ECG, but because this is something more of a German term, we call it oftentimes an EKG, which you may have heard of more commonly. An EKG could be helpful in diagnosing between whether a patient has myocarditis or pericarditis. And I think I showed you this animation earlier, where you can see here that there's an initiation of a signal that comes down and is spread downwards there and then comes back up through this myocardial wall. And as this is happening, there's a signal here that's being made, and it starts with a P wave, a Q, R, and then it's gone, S, and a T wave. And I'll draw that again in a minute, but these all happen. First, the P wave, as you have contraction of your atria. So see, when this pumps here, we'll have the P there. Then you have this QRS complex that's called together when the ventricle contracts. So as you see now, the red was where the ventricle was contracting. And then this T wave at the end is when it relaxes, the ventricle relaxes, and you can see the redness going back upwards, signifying that the ventricle is relaxing during this time. So this is what we look at in an EKG. This is the electrical signal of the heart that we're studying by putting some leads or stickers on someone's chest. So let's get rid of this thing. We see here that an EKG helps us to study the electrical signal in the heart. So the electrical signal of the heart. And we have different leads, or different, I guess, snapshots of the heart based on which direction we're looking at it from. And so a normal EKG would be flat like this, and then we would have a bump here. This is what's referred to as a P wave. This is where your atria would contract. And then there's a Q wave down here. So there's a Q where there's a spike down. And then the spike up right after is referred to as the R wave, the R. And then we have this spike down again, and then that's the S wave. And we usually refer to this together as the QRS complex. And then we have a flat line here before we get another wave, and this is our T wave. So this segment in between is known as the ST segment. I know that's a lot to mention right now. I'm not expecting you to memorize everything about EKGs, but these are the letters I'm about to refer to. And we see some fairly classic or characteristic changes with myocarditis versus pericarditis. So first, I have this EKG over here that we're trying to figure out, and this is actually going to be classic for myocarditis. So this is myocarditis because with myocarditis, all we see is what's referred to as tachycardia, and it's especially called sinus tachycardia when we're looking at a EKG because we have the correct rhythm. We have the correct rhythm, but our rate is a little fast. And as you might recognize, we've got our, and this lead right here as we follow through for this guy, we have our P right here. There's the QRS that's squeezed in there. And we've got the T right there before we start up with another P, which is right here. And so we've got all of the right waveforms that we need kind of shaped as they're supposed to, but this is kind of a fast rate to have. And so we've got sinus tachycardia with myocarditis here in this patient. Now another EKG we could look at here has some more specific changes that we can note, and this is what's associated with pericarditis. Pericarditis. And in pericarditis, what you'll see is diffuse ST segment elevation, ST segment. And I think I told you in our perfect EKG drawing that I did over here, because this is so perfect, this ST segment here is flat. If you look for the ST segment down here, notice that this is our baseline, but the ST segment is elevated right there. And if we look at the other leads as well, so this is flat on this dark red line, the ST segment is elevated right there as well. And so it's elevated here, so it's elevated in all of these leads that we're looking at. And these are flipped over, but this one, this lead right here, shows that we've got an elevation as well above this solid red line. And so we've got ST segment elevation, so I'll write an increase right there, because it rises up. And when you see this for pericarditis, it's classic, and you can actually diagnose it straight from here, and you don't need to move forward. We can start treating right away. For myocarditis, sinus tachycardia is not a very characteristic finding on EKG, so we'd have to do other tests. So let's move forward and talk about some other tests. Another test that we can order to look at the function of the heart is something that's referred to as an echocardiogram, And maybe the echo part of it gives it away, but we call this an echo for short. The echo part refers to the fact that we are only using sound waves or ultrasound to look at the heart. So I'll make these important notes here. We're using sound waves to look at the heart. So sound waves, which is great because we're using no radiation, which you might recall is actually a cause of pericarditis. So you'd want to avoid using radiation. And the other thing about it is that we study the heart's function. So we study the function of the heart with an echocardiogram because we're looking at an actual moving image. And this can help us differentiate between a patient that may have myocarditis, or pericarditis, as we'll see in these videos right here. Now this is an echocardiogram of the heart, and as we're looking at these, this is a four-chamber view right here. This is the right atrium, the right ventricle, the left atrium, and the left ventricle. And this is a patient actually that has mild myocarditis. And the way you can diagnose that or tell is if you look at the right ventricle here, look at how much compression you have here at this part. This is a really acute angle that closes whenever the heart beats. Relative to that over here in the left ventricle, we say that this is hypokinetic. Hypokinetic because it's not contracting the way it should. And so this is one of the things you get with myocarditis, where you have a dilation of the chamber and an ineffective ventricle that should be pumping blood out to the rest of the body. Now here's an echocardiogram at a different cut of the heart, and if we press play, you'll notice up here that there's a lot of fluid that's sitting between the heart and the pericardium. So that's the pericardium that's sitting up here, and this is because we have what's referred to as a pericardial effusion. It's an unusually large amount of fluid that's sitting in the pericardial space, and it's compressing the heart. It's preventing it from beating how it's supposed to. It's preventing it from filling with as much blood as it would like to pump out to the rest of the body. And this could be dangerous because then you get hypotension or low blood pressure and other adverse effects that are associated with it here.